Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Now we start our panel discussion . Please settle down. I'll request all of you to kindly put your phones to silent stroke off. We start with the first main session, panel discussion on agenda for national unity. May I now request Sri Ashok Malik, Press Secretary to the President of India, to kindly come onto the stage. Sri Ashok Malik is Press Secretary to the President of India. Prior to his current appointment, Sri Malik was a senior Indian analyst and commentator and distinguished fellow at the Observer Research Foundation. A frequent columnist, he wrote for a number of national and international publications. His areas of interest covered policies, India's political economy, and foreign policy. May I now request Sri Naresh Gujral, Member of Parliament, to kindly come onto the stage, sir. Sri Naresh Gujral is a Shiromani Akali Dal party politician and a member of the Parliament of India representing Punjab in the Rajya Sabha, upper house of the Indian Parliament. May I now request Sri Pawan Kumar Verma, National General Secretary, Janata Dal United, to kindly come onto the stage. Sri Pawan Verma is a former Indian Foreign Service officer and was an advisor to the Chief Minister of Bihar, Sri Nitish Kumar. He was a member of Parliament until July 2016. He is currently the National General Secretary and National Spokesperson of the Janata Dal United. In his career as a diplomat, he has served at missions in New York and Moscow, amongst others. He also worked with India's permanent mission to the United Nations. May I now request Sri Swapan Das Gupta, Member of Parliament, to kindly come onto the stage. Sri Swapan Das Gupta is the Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha. Is one of India's most widely read political columnists for last three decades, having worked in almost all the leading publications in India in senior editorial positions. He has been an independent columnist since 2003. In 2015, he was awarded the Padma Bhushan by the President of India. May I now request Sri Sajjad Lone kindly come onto the stage. Sri Sajjad Lone is member of the Legislative Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir. He is an Indian Kashmiri politician and member of the Legislative Assembly, elected from the Handwara constituency. He is the leader of the Jammu and Kashmir People's Conference. Finally, may I request Sri Bajant Jay Panda, former Member of Parliament, to come onto the stage, please. Sri Bajant Jay Panda is an Indian politician and former member of the Lok Sabha from Kendrapara constituency in Orissa. He is awarded the Bharat Asmita National Award for Best Parliamentary Practices by the Honorable Chief Justice of India in 2008. He graduated from the Michigan Technological University with a background in engineering and management and worked in the corporate sector before joining politics. I now request Sri Ashok Malik to take the proceedings from here.
Hello, is this working? Yeah, it is. Thank you, Alok ji. Good morning, friends. It's always a pleasure to be at the India Ideas Conclave, though this is my first time in Delhi. I think it's the first time for the conclave in Delhi. We are more used to the seaside venue of Goa. Let me begin by telling you about the format we'll follow today. Each of our five distinguished panelists will speak for about 7 to 10 minutes, depending on how long they want, after which we'll throw it open for questions and a free-flowing discussion, where I would urge you to actually ask questions more than offer opinions. Let me start by going straight away to Mr. Naresh Gujral. Mr. Gujral, the floor is yours. You can speak from here or up to you.
Thank you very much. I am honored to be asked to speak today to this distinguished gathering. When we deliberate on the agenda for national unity, we should perhaps look at the reasons that led to the balkanization of the Soviet Union and Yugoslavia, and the stress and internal threat that China is facing today to its unity. The Soviet Union essentially was fragmented for two main reasons. Its centralized authority lacked the capacity to regulate a huge economy, but more importantly, it failed to accommodate its diversity, both regional and ethnic. Power was concentrated largely in the hands of Russians, and non-Russians were left out of the privileges and protection. China, similarly, is witnessing similar discontent amongst its regional and ethnic minorities. In both cases, this centralization of power went hand in hand with corruption, nepotism, which further alienated those who are disenfranchised. We face similar challenges in India today. We are not a homogeneous people. There is no essential similarity in the culture, tradition, language, religion, food, festivals, even history of the various peoples of India. The gods that are worshipped by Hindus in Kerala would perhaps be very different from the gods that are worshipped in Uttar Pradesh. Diwali, Onam, Durga Puja, Christmas, or Eid, these are just a few of the festivals which are celebrated in India based on geography and religion. There is rich diversity of tradition and culture in our nation, and there can be no one definition of Indianness. Only a totalitarian state can create homogeneity, and history has shown that such an attempt is always doomed to fail. In our democracy, there is no option but to embrace these differences and to focus instead on the commonality that binds us as Indians to our unity in diversity. Governments must be magnanimous and tolerant towards dissent. Suppressing such voices only weakens our democracy, because a vibrant democracy has the inherent strength to tolerate all points of view. We must never forget the message of our Sikh gurus, the essence of which is tolerance, equality, fraternity, respect for all religions, and sharing, from which the concept of langar evolves. The recent speeches of Shri Mohan Bhagwat have also invoked this philosophy. And to quote him, and I quote, "India's diversity should be respected, celebrated, and should not be a reason for discord in our society. Hindutva is not a religion replete with codes, do's and don'ts. It is a value system that teaches unity in diversity, sacrifice, coordination, self-respect, and love," unquote. Hence, it is imperative that those forces or individuals who question this diversity and whose utterings or action create a sense of fear in the minds of minorities must be dealt with firmly, irrespective of the offices that they hold or the party that they belong to. After this country became independent in 1947, Sardar Patel, with a firm hand, unified the country by annexing the erstwhile princely states. At that point, many thought that India would not survive and would disintegrate. However, our democracy had taken firm root thanks to the founding fathers, who first gave India a sterling constitution and thereafter strived to strengthen the institutions that nurtured democracy. When the agitation against Hindi as a link language began, our leaders, such as Mr. Nehru, who was a prime minister, wisely remained flexible. And to quote his famous quote, he said, "Hindi is important, but national unity is more important." And that saved the day for the country. Regional aspirations were being accommodated. Similarly, we dealt with the agitations in the Northeast with patience and sagacity, and that has kept the country strong and united. That said, sadly, we have to accept that national unity has never been under as much stress as it is today. We are living in times when there is deep anxiety in the minds of minorities in our country, and growing unrest caused by economic disparity and political divisiveness. To keep India strong and united, there are urgent steps that need to be taken, both economic and political, and I will start with the economic steps. First and foremost, it is imperative to follow economic policies which result in balanced economic growth and development of all regions. Otherwise, it will lead to strife and violence. We have seen the Naxalite violence in areas of Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha, and parts of Andhra Pradesh, which has been going on for over 2 decades. And to my mind, the primary cause for this was a freight equalization policy of the Nehru government, which ensured that factories and industries were set up next to ports and metros, and those states which were rich in mineral resources were denied their due share. Otherwise, all these factories would have been set up there and those states would have developed. I am very happy that the current government has now recognized this and they have given the most favored treatment to the most backward districts of this country. Second, India has the highest working age population in the world. However, this demographic advantage can turn into a liability if we don't create jobs for our youth very fast. And to create jobs, I think two neat things need to be done. One, that we have to make sure that we attract FDI because our own savings rate is not enough, which translates into investment. And for that, we have to have harmony and tranquility on the street because FDI only comes where there is harmony. And they don't like policies which are erratic. So we must have consistent economic policies. And second to my mind, which is very important, is that we have to have some kind of an abhiyan for dignity of labor. Today, the service sector can create thousands and millions of jobs. But basically, our young people are looking for white-collar jobs and they shun blue-collar jobs. So we have to have a kind of a national campaign to bring them into this. There are dearth of mechanics for cars, motorcycles, TVs, any consumer items. You cannot find such people, carpenters, masons, but people want clerical jobs. So the youth has to be taken more towards this, and I think a national campaign needs to be launched for this. When we come to the political issues, I think the most important thing is for our society to stay civilized, we need the rule of law. And for rule of law, fear of the law is very important. Today, unfortunately, the courts hardly function. There is no expeditious delivery of justice. And as a result, the fear of law is gone. So I think if there is one reform that this country needs to usher in, which should be the first priority of the government, should be the judicial reform. And whatever money needs to be provided for this, for creating the infrastructure, should be provided. We have seen how our investigative agencies have behaved in recent days. Our people have very little faith in our police or investigative agencies. They are being increasingly seen as a repressive force. So it is urgent that we also usher in police reform. Our bureaucracy is inefficient, corrupt, and non-responsive. And this was supposed to be the steel frame of India, which unfortunately has corroded. So I feel that it must be made more accountable and freed from political pressure. India has survived for 70 years despite many contradictions because of our vibrant democracy. However, today it is under threat both from money power and gunda power. And I think for that, all of us are responsible. We all now say, my gunda is okay, but yours is not. So I think a stage has come when collectively we need to introspect and correct this. We talk of cooperative federalism, yet we shortchange the states by imposing various cesses on taxes. This deprives the states of their rightful revenue. And I feel that we must end this practice immediately as this leads to suspicion and anger in the states. I end with a warning to India's rulers to be careful not to repeat the mistake that Indira Gandhi made in the 60s. In 1968, India's per capita income was in dollar terms 106, while China's was 100. However, when blue-collar jobs were shifting from the US to the East, Mrs. Gandhi firmly shut our doors to that investment. The result was Nixon and Kissinger went to China, provided them with the capital, provided them with technology and an assured market. And today, China's economy is 6 times larger than India's economy. Hence, it is imperative to have institutional safeguards to ensure that economic and political decisions, which could have far-reaching consequences, are taken collectively and not left to the whims and fancies of any one powerful leader. In conclusion, I would say that when in doubt, we need only to turn to our constitution. The preamble itself talks of our country being a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, which promises its citizens justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity. We must always remember that none of these principles are optional if we wish to maintain the national unity, well-being, and success of our nation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gujral. You made one very astute point that the unity of the country must take into account the diversity and aspirations of our states. That's just a point we'll get back to later. I now invite Swapan Das Gupta. You could speak from here or there, as you choose.
Friends, first let me start off by thanking India Ideas Conclave for inviting me yet again. I've been associated with this initiative for many years now, since its inception. And each year, I find that this provides a basic framework for an exchange of ideas, and far more important, it also gives the opportunities for various like-minded individuals who are otherwise scattered all over the country to actually come together and meet each other. And sometimes I see that the feeling of isolation, which a lot of people otherwise nurture, gets dispelled when they actually come here and meet other like-minded people who have broadly common concerns. Now, that's the compliment part of it. Now, 3 days ago, I received an email from the organizers of this conference saying, we've scheduled a session for you, which is a conversation with the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh, Yogi Adityanath. So I wrote back, thank you very much, but in what language? Now, my friend Giri, who I met here, said, I was really hoping you'd accept that because we wanted a version of the Cartoon Network here. Now, am I to conclude that just because my Hindi is, to put it mildly, an instrument whereby you can learn Bengali, does that mean that I should share Navjot Singh Sidhu's idea that it's impossible for him to interact with people from southern India, he being a Sadaji from Amritsar? Now, I get along very famously with Naresh Gujral, who also comes from Punjab, whose background goes back to West Punjab. I get along famously with my friend Baijant Panda, who speaks in Uriya and English. I'm sure if I lapse into Bengali, he'll understand it, just as he lapses into Uriya, I can understand it. With his chief minister, I have no problem. We have a common language, which is not Uriya. So the question really arises, and this comes up numerous times. For instance, Bengalis like me, we celebrated Durga Puja a few days ago. It's a lavish festival, 5 days of festivities, etc. Now, one of the things about Durga Puja is that there is very little restraint as far as food is concerned in those 5 days. The Bengalis are temperamentally non-vegetarian, although there are certain days when they have vegetarian food. Whereas in Navratri, which is equally a festival which coincides with that, the fare is almost entirely vegetarian. Now you can say that what links, and I'm taking off from Naresh Gujral's intervention here, what links the two? This is diversity. Yes, it's diversity. But is it really difference? That's a question which I want to pose to you. There is fundamentally, it's a question worth probing. Why do so many Indians interact with each other? Why is it that the footsteps, that the footprints of our pilgrimage centers are not local specific? Why is it that Bengalis go to Puri? It's one of the most sacred sites for Bengalis. Why do they go to Kamakhya in Assam? Why do they go to Varanasi? There is something in India which is called a sacred geography. It's a term which I'm using from someone else. There is that unity. And that unity is not determined whether Lord Ayappa is worshipped in that avatar in Assam, or whether the form of worship, the Shakta form of worship in eastern India differs fundamentally from the Shakta temples in southern India. There are important differences. There are differences in rites. Why is it that in the Amarnath caves, the priest is a Nambudri Brahmin from Kerala, one extreme to the other? So there is something which is inherently Indian. A lot of people can get misled. A certain, in the 19th century, Lytton Strachey, for instance, pointed out that the first thing to learn about India was that there is, there never was, and there never will be an India. That was the perception he had, based on the fact that, oh, they're very different. The Rajputs are very different from the Tamils. They're very different somewhere else. Yes, there is an element of superficial difference. But what binds it is something else. And it's that, it's very intangible to be able to try and codify what binds, what defines the unity of India. If you try and write it down, what are the 10 points that were? You'll get someone else saying, no, that's not true, that's not true. And you'll get the Siddhu type conclusion. So people have tried to get out of this and say, look, this is too complicated a subject for us to address. So the basis of unity of India has to be the constitution of India. This is a notion which is increasingly coming into vogue, a subject called constitutional patriotism. It's a word you'll find increasingly being used more and more. We've heard this term called constitutional morality. We'll use the term constitutional patriotism. It's a term which was borrowed from Germany in 1945. It was a term which was brought in partly because in 1945, Germans wanted to make a new start because they had a very, very troubled history which they did not want to invoke. So they said, how do we put a curtain on the past? And how do we only see 1945 as year zero. Now, are we going to say that for us, 1950, the year the Constitution was invoked, or say 1947, is the year zero for India? That is very troubling. Because that negates the very basis on which our nationhood is centered. The Constitution is very important. And Naresh Gujral is entirely right to say that we should, because it sets out the rules of public life. And it's important that the rules of public life must be specified. What can be done, what cannot be done. But it certainly does not define what the basis of nationhood is. How could socialism define what the basis of? The moment you tried to codify something called secularism, you got yourself into even bigger muddle. Before that, it was a nebulous, understated, understood thing. For some people, it meant equality. For some people, it meant tolerance. For some people, it meant irreligiousness. But it was left somewhere out there. The moment you try and codify things, you get into problems. Just like you've got into problem in Sabarimala, where a notion of abstract equality goes against certain long traditions. It's that superimposition of one on the other. So the diversity of India, whereby Lord Jagannath sleeps, I think from 12 to about 3 o'clock is the time when the mandir is closed, in the Puri temple is closed, because Lord Jagannath is having his rest. Now, if you say, look, that violates the working hours in public places. It would be an interesting argument. And no doubt that argument could work in some places. But if you were to use that argument and put it there, you're going to get yourself into all sorts of muddle. There are customs. When we go to Gurdwaras, we cover our heads. It's sign of basic respect for a custom. It's also an acknowledgement that in India, whether it's the Hindu religion or what is called Hindu religion, whether it's a religion at all or it's a larger civilizational concept, is thing. Whether the type of Islam practiced in Jammu and Kashmir is the same as that in Saudi Arabia? It's not. The belief structures are at some places very, very different. Biggest challenge to our cultural diversity, the biggest challenge to our sacred geography actually lies in this mindless imposition of a single norm on India. And I think this point I would like to hammer, that it is not a question of equality of everything, one size fits all for everything. It cannot be. And Naresh was quite completely right, that the one size fits all policy when it came to freight equalization in eastern India caused absolute havoc. There was this notion called the redistributive center. Now, there is an element of redistributive center which is very, very important. For instance, when Bihar was divided between Jharkhand and Bihar, all the mineral-rich areas went to Jharkhand, and Bihar was left as an agricultural thing. Now, you needed a helping hand. You need a helping hand for Bihar to climb up. So, I would say that when we are talking about the unity of India, let us not try and codify things. Let us remember that at the end of the thing, it is very much an emotional construct, and it is everything which needs to be done to enhance that emotional connect between all parts of India, to be aware that it's there, to have a certain degree of innate respect. Not like what Shashi Tharoor says, why does the Prime Minister go and wear funny hats in Nagaland? Funny hats. Now someone might think the turban in Rajasthan is funny. So it's that, those people today who claim that they are the greatest architect of unity are basically today talking about a mindless uniformity. And it's that uniformity which, again to go back to what Naresh said, was responsible for the disintegration of the Soviet Union, which will probably lead to greater stresses and strains in China, and which is the bane of modern existence, the quest for modernity disguised as uniformity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shopan. I'm struck by a phrase you use, that above all, the unity of India is an emotional construct. It is so true, and someone who realized it 1,000 years ago was Adi Shankaracharya. And Pavan Verma, our next speaker, has written several books, including most recently a biography of Adi Shankaracharya. Pavan, could I invite you to speak?
नमस्कार आज मुझे यहाँ आप लोग ने आइडियाज कॉन्क्लेव के लिए आमंत्रित किया मैं तहे दिल से इसके लिए अपना आभार प्रकट करता हूँ विचारों का मंथन हमारे देश की एक परंपरा रही है और मत भिन्नता अगर हो भी तो उम्मीद तो यह है कि मतभेद नहीं इसलिए आई एम वेरी हैप्पी टू बी हियर टुडे टू स्पीक ऑन अ सब्जेक्ट व्हिच आई थिंक हैज अ स्पेशल इंपॉर्टेंस व्हेन यू कंसीडर द क्वेश्चन ऑफ नेशनल यूनिटी इफ वी वर टू बिगिन बाय पोजिंग टू क्वेश्चंस इज देयर अ थ्रेट टू नेशनल यूनिटी Or conversely, is this unity not strong enough? And I will posit for you that the unity of India is based on a foundational strength which is near impregnable, which is beyond challenge. And yet, as citizens of a modern republic, we need to be vigilant about threats to that unity and be alert and define them when they arise. First of all, I must say that I disagree with my good friend Naresh Bhai when he says that India has no homogeneity and it is a collation of vast diversities. If I may submit with humility, that is actually a colonial argument. It was Winston Churchill, with his otherwise erudite but transparent hubris, who said that India is merely a geographical expression. And to say that India is a nation is to say the equator is the nation. He too, like many foreign observers, was mesmerized by the surface, superficial, obvious diversity of India and missed the essential substratum of unity, which is based on a civilizational legacy. I say this to you because ancient civilizations as they evolve, and when a group of people in a defined geographical area evolve in one crucible over 5,000 years, there is bound to evolve within them certain similarities and overlaps which give them an identity of their own which is easily and verifiably identifiable. 1,200 years, Ashok mentioned my latest book, Adi Shankaracharya. 1,200 years before, Adi Shankaracharya, in his short life of 32 years, set up 4 mathas. One was in Sringeri in the south, Dwarka in the west, Puri in the east, and Joshimath in the north. That was the civilizational map of India. It did not need to be discovered only when we became a nation. So there is a strong civilizational unity, and even if you go into some of the superficial diversities, you will see, you will be surprised. I am myself surprised as I travel in this country. There are festivals, and each of them may have a different name, but all of them fall almost on the same day and are celebrated for the same reason. You may see this from the north to the south. Take classical music. Those who listen to Carnatic music or those who listen to North Indian traditions of classical music may find the difference in the rendering of a rag, but the notes of a rag are inflexibly the same. The names can be different, but the rags are the same. Take the question of language. Almost all the languages of India have been reduced now to their association with one basic language, and if not, can be classified into 4 basic language groups. Take dance. I used to be DG ICCR, sir, and if you stand anywhere in India like this, you don't have to give fatiguing explanations. It is Krishna. From Manipur to the south, you have the traditions of classical Indian dance, which are on themes which are similar, which overlap, which unify, which reinforce the same traditions of both philosophy and aesthetics. After all, 600 years before the birth of Christ, you had a man called Bharat, who wrote a volume called the Natya Shastra. The Natya Shastra is not a compendium of the arts. It is 6,000 Sanskrit shlokas on what constitutes the aesthetic experience, rasa. This is a time when people had not come down in many parts of the world from trees. And you had a manuscript of this nature. So when you go back, I was also a little surprised to hear about the number of religions in our country. Yes, 4 of the great religions of the world were born in India. Hinduism, Sikhism, Jainism, Buddhism. And we also have in very large number the adherents of the Islamic world, Islam. But let me tell you, of all these religions and their differences which we must respect, when I'm talking of unity, I do not mean for a moment that we do not respect diversity. But let not diversity make us believe that there is no underlying unity. Hinduism, Sikhism, you know, the notion of Advait, Aham Brahmasmi, Tat Tvam Asi. Look at Sikhism, Naresh. Ek Omkar. A Shabad says, Nirankar, Niradhar, Nirahar, Nirvikar. It is pure Advait, pure Hinduism. Buddhism and Hinduism have so many overlaps. The only difference is the beach word in my view of Buddhism is Dukkha and the way out of Dukkha. Sorrow and the way out of sorrow. And the beach word of Hinduism is Anand. joy. You were joy, you are joy, you will be joy. But otherwise, both are the same. Even in areas like Islam, the Sufi tradition, I mean, you mentioned Swapan Ayappa just now. When you go up to the shrine in pilgrimage, all pilgrims, be they Hindus or Muslims, stop at a shrine which is a dargah. They stop at the dargah and pray. Amir Khusro sang songs entirely on Hindu themes. Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti in Ajmer gets pilgrims which are Hindus and Muslims. At least in the Sufi tradition, there is a syncretism which is part of this unity which underlines the essential civilizational profile of India. And we must recognize that. Secondly, and this is an important point, post-1947, based on this civilizational unity, there has developed over a time a pan-Indianness, which has evolved in an organic manner without a prepared blueprint, and that is what gives it strength. It could have been for a variety of reasons. Job mobility, educational opportunity, radio, television, the revolution in communications, mobile telephony, domestic tourism, consumerism, aspiration, improved communication networks. There could be 100 reasons, but over a period of time, we have noticed that even though we were a civilizational unity, there was a time when someone in Varanasi knew very little about Madurai. But today what has happened is that as a result of this gradual evolution of pan-Indianness for a variety of reasons, which are part of your life and my life, what has happened is that the salad bowl of India has become a melting pot. Today, there are not distinct constituents of a larger unity, but those constituents have melted into an organic unity. And it's important to understand this, that every Indian in every part of India has at least one symbol, if not several more, by which he or she can identify himself or herself with Indians as a whole. And this has happened gradually over the last 60 to 70 years. In fact, about Navjot Singh Sidhu, I want to say, while he may be right, and this is not something to quibble about, I don't think he was being anti-national. But Daler Mehndi once told me that his Punjabi pop disc CDs, for some reason, sold the most in Kerala, where people did not understand the meaning but enjoyed the music. And this is exactly what India is. So this kind of differentiation, frankly, doesn't matter. Now, three possible areas which we should be vigilant about, and I'll end with that. The first is that I don't think that we should subject bona fide citizens of our country periodically or prescriptively to the test of nationalism. I believe ultra-nationalism, by which one person or a group of people presume to certify what is the level of nationalism within you, as though, as I once said, they have a syringe to measure the amount of nationalistic bacteria in your blood, I think that needs to stop. Because we are inherently and proudly, as citizens, patriotic without getting certificates from people or being judged by somebody else's prescriptive description or ritual of what makes one nationalist. Secondly, I believe that one should be vigilant about the misuse of religion, When I say misuse, in our firmament today, where the immediate overwhelms the long-term or medium-term good, very often we use instruments for immediate success, which are in the long-term deleterious or harmful to the national good. Essentially, I want to tell you that all Indians want to swim away from the hold of mullahs and mahants to the dividends of the secular mainstream. Arey bhai, naukari hai, sadak hai, pani hai, bijli hai, aspatal hai, school hai, jiske paas scooter hai, wo chahta hai maruti kharide, jiske paas maruti hai, wo chahta hai badi gaadi kharide, jiske paas cycle hai, wo motorcycle. It's a cycle of aspiration. People want to get on with their lives. They do not wish to be part of religious divides which are imposed on them, and which I believe can be dangerous to the project of national unity. Thirdly, and this was mentioned again in passing by Swapan, we must ensure, and I say this not because I was a member of parliament representing Bihar, we must ensure in the project of national unity equitable regional development. You cannot have a situation where 95% of all public and private resources go to five relatively developed states, and there is a developed or relatively developed India moving towards greater development, and another part of India which, for reasons beyond its control, remains irrevocably bogged down in a vicious cycle of poverty. And this kind of situation requires interventionist affirmative action. And that is the duty of the governments who are in power. And that is why I believe that ignoring this problem could ignite tensions within the larger fabric of unity, which can be addressed if timely action is taken.
Could I urge you to just...
Yeah, last point. Constitutional... What did you say, Swapan? Constitutional patriotism. I find it an interesting phrase, and I was well educated by Swapan's mention of it. I just want to say this. It's not an either-or situation. Many evolving nations have a clash between what is the law and what is the entrenched tradition. The maturity of nations depend on how they resolve that clash, not by undermining one or overlooking the other. I believe the Constitution is one of the guiding lights of our nation, and the rule of law that it prescribes must be maintained. You cannot find reasons to ignore it, because that will undermine the national unity more than anything else. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pavan. I must say in passing, your reference to Daler Mehendi and being popular in Kerala reminded me of the first time I heard A.R. Rahman. It was in 1994. I was driving through Odisha to Koraput. I had an Odia driver who didn't understand Hindi, and I didn't understand Odia, but he was listening to Kadalan, which is a Tamil film for which A.R. Rahman had composed the music. And we both loved the music. Neither of us understood Tamil. So that tells you something. Our next speaker is Sajjad Lone from MLA from Jammu and Kashmir. And I'd like him to offer his perspective, please.
A very good morning to all of you here. And my thanks to India's India Ideas and Conclave for giving me a chance to speak. Now, I come from the northernmost part of the country, and national unity becomes even more profound when we start from there. While I was trying to think what I will start with, since national unity is such a vast subject, I thought, let me focus on national identity. What is our national identity? What is my national identity? And can there be a national identity which can be confined to a sentence, to a paragraph? Can nationalism be scripted? Can it be one size fits all? That you say this is what concept of Indianness should be and everybody follows? Or should it be an evolving concept? My belief is that Indianness, concepts of nationalism, who you are, what you are, cannot be static. What it meant to be an Indian even 50 years back is not what it is today. There's a lot of difference. What it meant to be British 70 years back, 100 years back, the stereotype British was a person with a hat, suited tie, stiff upper lip, and white. Britishness today is different. What about the pan-European identity, the American dream? You no longer have white faces. You have brown faces, you have black faces, you have turbaned people. And apart from assimilation, I think largely there has been accommodation. If we talk of accommodation and assimilation, then it becomes a prescripted concept of nationalism. I personally don't think that we can predefine Indianness. I believe it's nonlinear, fluid, and can assume any form and could change form every 2 or 3 decades. Is it about sameness or differentness, diversity or pluralism? I believe it's the differentness, the capacity of a country to encompass the differentness, the diversity, and yet have common attributes. The commonalities, they are a common thread. Virtues, history, they are a common thread. But at the end of the day, it is the differentness and the power of the country to encompass them, accommodate them, that is of vital importance. I would say that if we look at our country, and even if we look at this hall, the color of the skin, the religion, features, Oriental, Dravidian, Aryan, they're all different. And yet, we call most of us are Indians. But national unity in the longer run, as Pabanji was talking about Sadak Pani, I would say economic empowerment across gender, race, region is perhaps the most important cementing force in national unity. The great American dream is based on equal opportunities, affirmative action, and explicit affirmative action in a world which is based on free market, which is based on merit, but yet they go for affirmative actions. And a kind India, a soft India, and when I say that, I mean the social welfare benefits. How the country looks after its poor people, its old, its infirm, is a common attribute. It reaches all across. I think there's a lot of space where we could work on economically empowering these sections which have been normally left out. When you look at threats to national unity, one is the physicality of the threat, which is based in military interventions. I personally don't believe that in today's age, the might that our country has, that anybody could dare make an intervention. They could sneak in, do terror attacks. That is also a threat, but the biggest threat could be from within. What are the threats that every country faces in national unity and not specific to India? Is majoritarianism. If there is a hint of supremacy in the majority population, that creates a real threat in the longer run. Or insecurity, or competitive nationalism, one size fits all nationalism. I think while we look for common attributes, the soft, take yoga for example, it is now truly an Indian concept, accepted not within the country, but in all parts of the world. Take our film industry, a soft power, but is identified with Indianness. And like, take food, masala dosa, biryani. These might be small, trivial things, but they really do represent the Indian cuisine. Some things that we do represent the Indian culture. So there will be this common thread, but we have to be careful that these common threads are, at the end of the day, very fragile. And I would again focus that evolving concept of nationalism and evolving concept of Indianness, giving everybody the freedom to be what they are, is the essence of national unity. I studied in Britain. What I found was unique was that if you study in town A in a university, the probability of the students of town A studying in that university is almost zero. So students from Delhi would be scattered all across the country, but not Delhi. Students from Mumbai, all across the country, but not Mumbai. That I believed at that time also, and even today, is one of the best examples of scattering younger people all across the country so that they pick up the common attributes. These are some things that we could do, but I hope that an educationally empowered India, socially empowered, politically empowered, and an economically empowered India, say in 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 30 years from now, the concept that would evolve would have more common attributes than they have today. I thank once again all of you for listening to me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sajjad. You made a very valid point that as our economy grows and becomes more interdependent, actually our unity enhances. Our final speaker is Jay Panda, no stranger to any of us and to this conclave. Jay, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I too would like to congratulate Ram Madhav ji and the entire India Foundation team for this fifth edition of the India Ideas Conclave, which has become a premier event for discussing ideas and where India is headed. I'd like to touch upon four main points in talking about an agenda for national unity. One, the economy. Two, the state. Three, culture. And four, politics. It's very clear that if we are unable to have high growth rates, if we are unable to provide jobs for tens of millions of what is usually called our demographic dividend, if we are unable to gainfully engage this large section of Indians, the national unity is at serious threat. In the past, we have missed several buses. Even while we consolidated our democracy in the early decades of the Republic, many others who were in our economic condition took rational economic decisions and converted themselves from third world nations to first world. Even large nations like China have become middle income countries, and because of the size of the population, hugely influential as a second pole to the United States. We have gradually, over the past quarter century, changed the trajectory of our growth. But even today, you will find remnants of that legacy where we argue about economic growth. There is a valid argument to be made about sharing the benefits of that growth with equity. But these are not in contradiction with each other. That we need high growth rates should be undisputed. And every step that we can take towards attaining high growth rates should be supported. Beyond that, we can and we must have a debate about how to make that equitous. But you will still find, whether in Parliament, in our media, many activists, that we continue to question the fundamental necessity of growth. And I posit something here, that if we have high growth rates as a fundamental precursor to any other discussion, to any other debate, almost most of our problems will fall into place, including national unity. I often am involved in track two discussions and foreign policy issues, and one of the arguments I make is the biggest foreign policy initiative we can take is actually a domestic one, which is to have double-digit growth rates for two or three decades, like China has done. New challenges are coming up because of artificial intelligence, robotics. Large percentages of existing jobs all over the world, in the US, in China, in Europe, and in India, are at stake. And unless we adapt, we will miss perhaps the final bus that will be available to our republic to bind us together. State. My friend Naresh Gujral made a point which I completely endorse, is that the state is not able, does not have the capacity to deliver the basic requirement of every citizen, which is justice. I agree that of the many reforms that we need to do, judicial reform is at the very top. Courts in my state, in Odisha, have not functioned in the last 2 months. But even where courts function throughout the country, there is no assurance of justice, and definitely no assurance of timely justice. Until we do that, any talk of national unity will always be undermined by these uncertainties and by the inevitable manipulations that various stakeholders will indulge in when justice is not sure and not swift. But there are other issues about the state's incapacity. We have a constitution that we are proud of, but we have had an odd shift where people who are accused of being fascists are repeatedly swearing their allegiance to the constitution. People who have tom-tommed their liberalism over the decades are the ones questioning many aspects of our constitution. I have written extensively about secularism and liberalism as it exists today in India, which vitiates the fundamental idea of those two concepts as they existed traditionally. I don't have the time to go into that at length here, but I do request you to Google and read some of these articles that I have written. What the Indian state indulges in is by no stretch of imagination can be called secularism, because it interferes in one religion. There is no other country in the world that would call itself secular when the state administers the places of worship of only one religion. This is a legacy of the divide and rule policies of our colonial era. We must be true to the objectives in our constitution and bring about true secularism. Culture and language. My friend Shapun Dasgupta spoke eloquently about it. I will just add that I have had conversations with friends where we argue about what it means to be an Indian, and can I say I am an Odia? Does that make me less of an Indian? It doesn't. It is perfectly normal, perfectly acceptable for each one of us to be an Indian and a Bengali, to be an Indian and a Tamil, to be an Indian and a Hindu, to be an Indian and be a Muslim. You don't necessarily have to have one identity. Multiple identities are absolutely fine, and certainly in the 21st century, if we insist that we have one homogeneous identity, it's not going to work and it's not necessary. You can already see technology having an impact on some of these atavistic constraints that we have put around ourselves. For the last several years, whenever I've traveled to a country whose language I don't speak and where English is not very prevalent, I use a translator on my smartphone and I'm able to have fairly normal conversations with people vocally, just having it translated back and forth. The day is not far away when instantaneous translation of any language to any language through the use of technology will be a fact of life. This is something not worth arguing about, not worth having divisions about. Finally, I would like to say a couple of words on our politics. There are some of us who have argued that a nation as large and as diverse as us deserved to have a presidential form of government. And the reason for that is there is no other democracy in the world which is large and has a Westminster parliamentary model. The Westminster parliamentary model has its advantages. But when it comes to large countries and diverse countries, this is not what it evolved for. It evolved for small, homogeneous countries. And its constraints come out in many different ways. Again, I don't have the time and space to go into the details of this. We can have a conversation in Q&A, or once again, I can promote my writings by asking you to Google and read some of the articles I've written on this. What this has led to in our politics is two competing forces. Forces which benefit from fragmentation, and forces which benefit from unifying. Now, in the system that we have, even a small percentage of the vote share can give disproportionate political authority, political power to an individual or a group. Whereas there ought to be a balancing between the elected authority of the nation having the ability to implement their agenda, because that is what has been endorsed by voters, but not in a whimsical manner without checks and balances. Checks and balances don't mean that every small grouping that manages to get a vote has a veto. That's not democracy. That would be running a country by consensus. It would be impossible to run a country that way. And we are seeing examples of that impossibility in many aspects of our everyday life in India. We need to make reforms. We need to implement reforms in our political system. We can continue having a parliamentary system, and we probably will, because there is no broad consensus on having a presidential system. But there is a pushback from the people itself. For a quarter century, for nearly three decades, we saw coalition politics running the government, and that's still around. It's never going to go away. But for the first time in three decades, we saw the triumph of the unifying forces hold or run the government for the first time. This theme, this conflict between fragmenting forces and unifying forces, is not going to disappear. This is going to be the yin and the yang of Indian politics going forward. The people of India will not always vote one way or another. They might change their mind from time to time, and that's okay. But it's not okay to pretend that India is so diverse that it ought not to be a country, that it can only be run with groupings who each have a veto. That will not work. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jay. Friends, we have about 20 or 25 minutes of time left. We had about 15 minutes, but the organizers have told me we can go up by another 10 minutes. I'll start with a few questions which I've jotted down here for our panelists, after which we could move to questions from the audience. I'd urge the panelists to keep their responses short. My first question is to Naresh Gujral and Pawan Verma, who's on the phone, because they both represent regional parties. Why is it that you hear more concern and debate about what is India and Indian unity and the concept of Indian unity in Delhi rather than in the rest of India, the real India? Is it because these debates are only heard in Delhi, or is it because the rest of India has a more relaxed view of Indian unity? And so, Pawan, the question I had for Mr. Gujral and then for you is that why do we hear more debates and questions and concerns about what is India and Indian unity in Delhi, in the hothouse of Delhi, rather than in the real India, in the states of India? Is it because there's just a more relaxed view of the unity of India in the states? So, Naresh Gujral and then Pawan Verma.
I don't think there is any doubt in anybody's mind about the unity. That is a fact which we all accept, and that is a reality. But it is also a fact that the unity, I wouldn't use the word threatened, but gets weakened when minorities feel insecure. And unfortunately, time and again, statements are made, certain actions are done by those who are close to the centers of power, which create these doubts in the minds of the minorities. And I have said it openly and I have said it publicly. At times, action needs to be taken against such forces and such people, irrespective of the party that they belong to. Mere warnings will not do. So, coming back to your question, it is not that Delhi has a relaxed view. Delhi, at the end of the day, we all of us who represent various states sit in Delhi, and we represent the views of the states. So, one can't say that the unity in any way is threatened, but we have to ensure that it is not weakened.
No, I think that Delhi will debate matters which other people take for granted. When I say take for granted, what does it mean? A person from Amritsar goes to Chandigarh. He's called an Amritsari. From Chandigarh, he comes to Delhi, he is called a Punjabi. He accepts that. When he goes abroad, he is called an Indian. So the same person then becomes an Indian by a natural evolution without necessarily having to question issues in detail about his identity. And ultimately, Ashok, if you will allow me to end my answer to your question, there's a simple Urdu couplet. Sudhanshu ji, ijazat hai? Garibul Watan means exile. And for many people, India is home, and home means unity, and unity is unchallenged. So the couplet is, palat rahe hai garibul vatan, palat rahe hai garibul vatan, palatna tha. Wo koocha roo kashe jannat ho. That place may be the mirror image of paradise. Wo koocha roo kashe jannat ho. Ghar hai, ghar, phir bhi.
Swapan also wants to make a point.
Yeah, well, you know, firstly, let me, as an aside, there's a wonderful couplet which Pawan just now said, but whenever I hear Urdu couplets, I have one small request. Please do provide subtitles, which in Delhi sometimes you don't. Subtitles. I think the issue really is not so much whether what is India is discussed in Delhi disproportionately. What has recently come into vogue, particularly end of 2013 or so, was the sudden emergence of something called the idea of India. And I want to emphasize this, that it's always idea in singular. I think all of us discussed something today, which is that there are various ideas of India. It's in the plural. That the moment you try and say there is an idea of India, you also mean that there are certain people who are custodians of this idea of India. And I think that's really where the problem is. Today, some people have said, we have a proprietary interest, maybe family interest, maybe other forms of interest, in what is defined as India, that anything which deviates from it is not India. And then the yardstick on which the criterion for which this idea of India is completely arbitrary, it is decided on what is expedient for the moment. And Delhi being unfortunately a hothouse of those who wield intellectual capital, naturally has this greater say. And I would say that's really what the problem is.
Well put, Shopan. My next question, and my final question before I throw it open, is to Sajjad Lohan. Sajjad, when I first visited Kerala about 10 years ago, I had an afternoon free. I told the driver, take me to an emporium so I can buy some Kerala artifacts and take it back home. So I went to a shop, it was cottage emporium, whatever it was. It was run by a fine young man from Barabola. So we had a long conversation. I bought stuff and came away. Some months later, my wife and I happened to go to Goa and went to a local shop there. It was run by a young man from the Kashmir Valley. We again bought something, had a good conversation, and we left. The relationship between Jammu and Kashmir or the Kashmir Valley and the rest of the country has a long history. I don't need to go into that. But the economic and educational opportunities that access to the rest of India provides, this unity provides, they're also undeniable. Can one compensate for the other, or for the troubled history?
Compensate in the sense?
In the sense that how do people in Kashmir, in the Kashmir Valley, how does a young person in the Kashmir Valley weigh the troubled history and the opportunities that unity throws up?
You see, the unfortunate part is that while I would not underplay the troubles in Kashmir, but if you look at the violence, you don't need a huge majority to create violence. You'd be amazed to know that I think at least 7,000-8,000 people, maybe the numbers are high or maybe lower, higher than this or lower, in Srinagar city, or people who sell shawls in Calcutta, they speak Bengali language quite fluently. Well, colloquial, but they are able to understand and speak. Then, in my area of influence or constituency, around 20,000 go to Punjab to sell shawls every year.
And in this turmoil, they go to Himachal, they go to turmoil. One place where they said there were very little complaints and that they looked after us, that the troubles in Kashmir did not trouble them, that was Calcutta. And that is what I would call Indianness. For me, would be that distinctive, because in other parts also they were good, but they were hauled up to the police stations or asked. But in Calcutta, overall, I asked, and they said that there was no problem at all. They were sort of all embracing, they did not trouble us. So that is what we, that would be Indianness for them, that this is my country. Because of what is happening there, they're not pointing a finger at me. So I would say that's how it would work.
Thank you. We'll now throw it open to questions from the audience. There are mics going around. If you could identify yourself and ask a specific question. I see a couple of hands there. So one of you and then the other.
Hello. Namaskar. My name is Dr. Pankaj Sahai. My question is to any of the panelists regarding Article 25, the right to conscience, practice, religion. Now, as we all know, certain belief systems are prescriptive and mandatory. Once a person is in, as per the official charter, he or she cannot get out. Atheists are not allowed. Apostasy is punishable with death, for example. So my question is, if they themselves, these systems or institutions based on them, themselves deny a fundamental right, that is Article 25, how can they be admissible under the Constitution? What I'm trying to get at is unqualified equality. And we may also recall the quotes by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Tajamal Hussain, and H.C. Mukherjee in the Constituent Assembly debates. So my question to all of you, sir. Thank you.
I couldn't hear that. Could you repeat your specific question? Because initially the sound wasn't. Could you just repeat your question? Because initially it was, you weren't clear.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll repeat the whole thing again. Yeah. My question is relating to Article 25. The right to conscience, practice, religion. As we all know, certain belief systems are prescriptive and mandatory. Once a person is in, as per the official charter, he or she cannot get out. And atheists are not allowed. Apostasy is punishable with death, for example. Now the question is that these systems or institutions, they themselves deny a fundamental right, that is Article 25. So how can they be admissible under the Constitution? What I'm trying to get at is unqualified equality, no majority, no minority. We can also recall the quotes of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Tajamal Hussain, and H.C. Mukherjee in the Constituent Assembly debates regarding this question. So my question to you, sirs, thank you.
Jay.
It's a very relevant question. I think if you boil it down, it comes to the following. Can the state intervene in religion? The answer is actually yes and no. I have written extensively about this in distinguishing, for example, on the one hand, the state has banned sati. The state has banned discrimination on caste, and recently the state has banned instant triple talaq. When I say state, it means either government or legislature or Supreme Court. These are all valid because the Constitution first and foremost provides a guarantee to every citizen to individual rights, and these individual rights supersede any group rights. But I have distinguished this from state intervening in a religion where the individual rights are not fundamentally impugned. For example, places of worship. Now, when you take a place of worship, I've already made the argument that state has no business administering a place of worship of any religion. In India, it administers the places of worship of only one religion. Should not happen. Now, but if in a place of worship, something is being done, you just talked about death for apostasy. If somebody's life is at danger, the state can intervene. But in terms of religious practices, for the state to intervene in a place of worship, please understand, a place, anybody can practice religion in the privacy of their home the way they want. But anybody professing to be of a certain religion cannot impose his version of it on other people. So when you talk of a place of worship, it is the place of worship of a religion where a group worships. Now, the group consensus must prevail about what happens in the place of worship, except if somebody is in danger or of being harmed. So that is the principle that I would advocate. If you want to know more about this, you can Google my articles or we can discuss offline.
Thanks, Jay. There was one more hand there, and then I'll come to you. Another person had his hand up there. Yes, sir.
So, my language command on English is a bit less, and understanding levels too. What is this definition of tolerance which Naresh Gujralji was referring to? He says about this tolerance again. Can you kindly define tolerance, because we are hearing different kind of definitions from different people. And second question is, whether the minorities are feeling insecure, if so, from whom, or majority is feeling insecure these days, or some people in majority are feeling that minorities are feeling insecure. And because my understanding levels are also a bit less, after you answer, I request Sri Swadvamandas Guptaji to answer so that I can understand better. Thank you.
So we can get both Naresh Gujral and Swapandas Gupta to respond to that. Mr. Gujral. No, he said both of them.
I think as far as tolerance is concerned, we don't need to define tolerance. We know what tolerance means. Every Indian knows what tolerance is. In fact, I think every citizen of every country knows what tolerance is, that you don't try to make somebody else insecure by your speech or action. And when I refer to tolerance, and when I refer to making minorities secure, all I said was that nobody, whether he or she is from a majority or from a minority, should by their speech or action create any kind of fear in the minds of the minority. You want me to be more explicit? I will say so. When somebody says that Dr. Abdul Kalam Azad was a nationalist despite being a Muslim, what message does that convey? Or if somebody says that who don't agree with the present policies can go to Pakistan, what message does that convey? So all I'm saying is that minorities must be made to feel secure if after 34 years, those who were responsible for the massacre of the Sikhs have still not been punished. Does it create security in the minds of the minorities? Thank you.
Yeah, well, to come back to this question of tolerance, what exactly is tolerance? In the West, there is a libertarian ideal of what is called tolerance, which basically embraces the notion of free speech in a most absolute sense, including the right to offend. Now, you're maybe familiar with the Danish cartoons controversy at one time. Now, at one gathering somewhere in Europe, I was asked, why is it that this provoked, there was no controversy in India? So I said, the reason is very simple. The cartoons were available on the net. They could have been published by people. There was no preemptive restriction on people to publish it. But people did not, newspapers and other publications, except one very isolated case somewhere in Punjab, did not publish it because it was seen as a gratuitous insult. It was not something that happened accidentally, unintentionally, and you know, by the way, you've offended somebody. So, what I'm suggesting, therefore, is that the notion of what constitutes tolerance is also very, very culture specific. And what we in India have as tolerance is actually enormously expansive and generous compared to a lot of other countries. Not necessarily because of anything else. We don't like the idea of offense. We don't willfully like to offend. But the flip side of it is we take a far more expansive view. The differences, the diversity, which comes in very naturally, the fact that some of us eat with our hand, some of us have a rather lavish slurp of the food, some of us eat with knife and fork, it's all part of the same thing. Whereas what would be construed as rude, inoffensive, etc., somewhere else, with a very rigid form, our framework is far more expansive. And I think that's probably one of the greatest attributes of Indian civilization. It's probably one of the things which has also got to do with its size. And therefore, I don't think we, as a country, as a civilization, should feel at all defensive that our notion of tolerance is somehow very constricted and not the same and not corresponds to the very libertarian definition or what passes off as libertarian. And it is becoming increasingly so. Our sense of the past is far more. Do you realize that, you know, there's a very interesting debate which is now taking place in the United Kingdom. There was a resolution of the union in the University of Cambridge, which says that November 11th, which is a very important day in the history of Western society, European societies at least, and even in Australia and New Zealand, as Armistice Day, because one of the most horrific and costly world wars ended that day. And there is a tribute which is paid, it's at 11 o'clock, silent memorial to them. And they said there was an old mural which had been there in Cambridge. And they said, we will not observe November 11th because it's only a depiction of white men. Now that mural was created sometime in 1918, where these notions of political correctness, of what constitutes, what Sajjad was saying, you know, the notion of what is Britishness, how it's evolved has changed over the years. So our sense of tolerance is also one which expands quite a lot. Now there was a very interesting debate in the late 1970s or maybe early late 80s on the sati issue, and I think it was raised here. There was one isolated case of a sati in a place called Deorala, or what was thought to be a sati in Deorala. Now sati has been banned since the time of William Bentinck in the 1830s or so. So there's already a rigid criminal law against anything of sati. But at that time, the government, forced by certain people, had a law made against what was called the glorification of sati. Now, what did this mean in real terms? There are a lot of small temples in Rajasthan where there are, you know, small, very touching. I mean, if you go and see those, you know, how little, it was not a very wholesome practice is quite evident. From the fact that, you know, you see the size of the palm prints which are put there. And they used to put vermilion and other things on it. So there was an implicit thing that was Sati Mata. Now that veneration was not based on criminality. But to say any glorification of sati, again, trying to codify it, So tomorrow if I say, now this idea of resurrection is flawed, and we must have an idea, we must have a law against resurrection because someone might try to resurrect themselves. So you see, the moment you try and impose alien cultural notions into our system without actually digesting what the full implications are, you get into hideous distortions. And I think a lot of the tolerance debate has suffered a consequence of that. Thank you.
You know, this, as we conclude what has been a fascinating discussion, and I must thank Naresh Gujral, Swapan Das Gupta, Pavan Verma, Sajjad Lone, and Jay Panda. This concept of imposing alien ideas reminds me of, uncritically, reminds me of a visit to Nagapattinam, I think, in Tamil Nadu, after some years after the tsunami. There had been, a village had been reconstructed, and there was one very odd monument or construction in a corner, which was unoccupied. And I said, what is that? So that, they said that the American Foundation came to India and said that the best earthquake-resistant buildings are igloos in used by the Eskimos. So we will construct igloos for you in concrete in Tamil Nadu. So it was a very good idea in theory. Nobody used it because obviously it was completely alien to the local culture. So I think that is akin to what Chopin was trying to say. In terms of imposition of alien ideas. I'd like to thank everyone once again. I'd like to thank the audience and the organizers. And I'd like to hand over the mic now to the organizers, to India Foundation, to take us to, through the rest of the program.
I'll now request Sri Ashok Malik to felicitate the participants. I'll now request Ashok Ji to present a memento to Sri Naresh Gujral. We'll now request Sri Ashok Malik to present a memento to Sri Swapan Das. We'll now request Sri Ashok Malik to present a memento to Sri Pavan Kumar Varma, National General Secretary. We'll now request Sri Ashok Malik to present a memento to Sri Sajjad. Now request him to present a memento to Sri Bajan Jayapanda. I'll now request Sri Ashok Mittal to present a memento to the moderator of the session, Sri Ashok Malik. Thank ladies and gentlemen, we'll be starting with first Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture in 5 minutes' time. And the lecture will be delivered by Shri Arun Jetli ji, who will be taking question and answers from the stage. But because of health reasons, we'll request all of you not to come close to him or surround him in any way. We have 5 minutes break. We'll start the next session. 5 minutes.